Blog Talk Radio.
Should old acquaintance be forgot and never brought to mind? Should old acquaintance be forgot?
Welcome to the show, Talking the Shadows Radio. I'm your hostess, Shadow Lady, and my lovely co-host, Robin Sings.
Hello.
How are
y'all
doing?
Yeah, you can just call me Robin.
Okay, Robin. Oh, Robin, right off the bat, we have a caller. Should we take the call? Yes, let's do it. What do you think?
Oh, what the heck?
Yeah, let's just go right into it. All right, here we go. Welcome to the show. Who am I speaking to?
Hey, my ladies. It's Denise.
Denise.
Yeah.
Yes, hey.
How are you doing?
We're good. I'm good. I know I'm good. I think Robin is. Robin?
Yeah, I'm doing okay. Yeah.
Anybody pre-drinking yet?
Not yet.
No.
That would be an interesting show, though. Shadow Lady gets cracked.
Yeah,
so,
I know.
So how are things going?
Off on that tonight.
Are you ready for the new year?
Uh-huh, absolutely. Bring it on.
Out with the
and,
old and with the new?
Yeah, God.
So, yeah, we were trying to have a real positive show here. We want to focus on, you know, remembering things of the past year and then talk about the good things that we can start up with the new year and, you know, New Year's resolutions and all that kind of thing and making changes in ourselves and just, you know, it's scary times out there right now, and it's really important that we try to keep our heads held high and, you know, we just get through everything, whatever we got to do. We just bond together and we can do this.
Well, you know, the thing that's neat about the new year is that you can kind of take everything that you were disappointed with last year and put it away and say, you know what, it's time for me to look forward to next year. And I think that's what I like about the new year is that you could look forward to, you know, maybe do a little introspection and note things that you want to change and make those steps toward them and start the new year outright. So have you made any resolutions this year, Denise?
Oh, there's a lot. There's so much that I need to do, that I want to do. You know, of course, lose weight, get back in shape. You know, and then I'm currently in need of a car and in need of a place to live and, you know, like in another place. Of course, you know, once I get on my feet, then I need to, you know, be with, you know, my girls and like my daughters. I would love to see as many friends as possible that I haven't been able to, you know, see in person, and also communicate on the phone, hence I need to call you Robin and Lisa. there's just so much that I want to get done, and I'm very positive about starting the new year.
Well, that's good.
You can't beat that. I think a few of the things that you mentioned are in, like, the top 10 things that people want to change, you know, when they start the new year. It's at least two of them that you mentioned are top 10 New Year's resolutions. That is number one, you know, to get fit. Everybody wants to feel better and, you know, lose a little bit of weight. I know, you know, us ladies, we're really concerned about, you know, looking good and feeling good. And especially you being a mom, you know, it's important that you feel good. And so, and also, too, I think the number one reason that most people mention is that they want to get together with people that they love and care about more. You know, they want to make the commitment to spend more time with family and friends. And, In fact, I was reading the other day that almost 50% of Americans vow to appreciate a loved one and spend more time with their family during this time of the year. So it's kind of nice to put that in your mind, you know. Go out and enjoy an evening of camaraderie with your friends and family and make it a point to get together with those people that you love this year. So.
Oh,
I know,
yeah.
I want to. I miss my family terribly, unfortunately. My sisters are in California. If they're listening, hi, sisters. I miss them very much. So I think that's one of my goals this year, is to make sure that I get down there to see them. So.
Yeah, I think it's important, you know. I mean, especially because of the hustle and bustle of everything, and things are really tight money-wise. And, you know, sometimes you just can't, especially, like, I know, Robin, you're the same as me. I don't like to fly, and if you don't have the money to fly, that kind of nips that in the bud, too. So, you know, just even traveling.
I don't like to fly, but I will, because I like to travel. So it's kind of, you know, I'm kind of doomed from the beginning.
I refuse. But, you know, it costs a lot of money, you know, and depending on the holiday and stuff, it's always a lot more expensive to fly during holidays. And so sometimes you just kind of got to get in touch and just talk on the phone or Skype or things like we're doing right here, having our talk show and getting together with friends and just talking about different interesting topics. So that in itself is getting together, you know, and it's unfortunate that we can't see each other and actually physically go and walk around together, but it's still kind of neat.
Absolutely.
But it is important that, you know, we don't forget the important things. You know, it's a really stressful time, and this year a lot of people are afraid because it's 2012 and all of these Mayan things and scare people. And I think what we need to do, my personal opinion, is, well, let's take that with a grain of salt. Maybe it's true, maybe it's not, but the truth of the matter is, even if it is true, don't you want to live your life the best you can while you've got it? You know, you have to remember to cherish every day, cherish everyone that cares about you and you care about. Don't just, you know, worry about all these problems, and before you know it, you're not living your life. All you're doing is stressing. And stress is so detrimental to your health. It's probably the number one killer. You know, people talk about chemicals, and people talk about, you know, overeating, or people talk about, you know, taking medications that might hurt them, things like that. Yes, those all do cause cancer and things like that, but the worst thing is stress. Stress is horrible, and we all have to remember to just, you know, try to focus on the positives more and think about the good things in life that we still have going for us, no matter how hard it might get. So I kind of think that's a challenge with the way things are now. But it doesn't mean that we still can't have good times and we still can't focus on spending time with those we love and doing things we enjoy, whether it's going to a rock concert or maybe it's going to a Broadway show or maybe just a movie or walking in the valley and enjoying the flowers and, you know, the sense of nature. So that's my take on it. What about you, Robin?
Well, I know that, you know, this the whole 2012, everybody's, you know, you hear talk of people being concerned and you know, like you were talking about, fearful, but I really just are setting my sights on personal goals this year, because there are some goals that I need to make for myself, and sometimes those bigger things, I think, take care of themselves. And maybe, I don't know, does that sound like I'm discrediting them? I don't think so, but I know the things that I need to change in me and in my life, and I think those, you know, those all eventually affect the whole. You know, as I make those changes in my life, then I think that, and people see that, then, you know, if I change my world, then my world changes. And so, I don't know, maybe that's, what do you think? I'm just focusing on that this year, really. I know, you know, because a lot of times with those things, especially the predictions of, you know, the end of the world and all this kind of thing, I just, you know, I don't really have any control over that. But what I can control is what I do and how I act and what I can change in my life. And that's where I want to focus my energy this year, I think.
Well, that's very good. That sounds very much like what I'm saying, you know, just focus on the positives and you know, we can't control.
'Cause we all have negativity that happens to us. We all have things. And really, you know, I want to hear people that are waiting to call in. I know that we have a few callers that are probably waiting right now. But I want to hear people what their hopes are for the coming new year. What resolutions that they might have. What advice that they might have for people out there that are, you know, feeling it a little down. You know, maybe their year didn't turn out as well. Maybe they feel like they don't have anything to look forward to. Maybe they can call in and give those people some advice. So
yeah, absolutely.
Go ahead and call in.
Yes, please call in, and we want to hear what your resolutions are. If you don't believe in resolutions, why? Because I know a lot of people get frustrated. So many people. I forget what the exact amount of people is as far as polls go, but more people than not, or more people than do, however you want to word that, and they end up giving up on their goals and that. And that's life in general, really. But when it comes to the New Year's thing, everybody wants so much to start the new year with all these positive changes and trying to, like, you know, losing weight.
How many times have we set goals and we said we're really going to do it? But I know that there are a few things that I'm definitely going to do this year. But, you know, you really got to put attention to it. And it depends on if those things are important to you or if they're not. It could be, you know, just going to the Grand Canyon. Maybe that's a goal that you have or something that you want to do or accomplish this year. So whatever it is, taking your kids to Disneyland or anything, we want to hear from you. So, Alyssa, what's the number? 4-2.
Oh, she's not on the phone. I'll do it.
Oh, I thought she was.
She's in chat. 424-243-9676. The number again is 424-243-9676. Please call in. I see some people in chat, and we'd love to hear from you. Please pick up your phone, dial in, and we want to hear from you. So call us. Ah, it was magic. We got a call. All right, here we go. Actually, here, let me do this. See? It's magic.
It's magic.
It's magic.
Magic.
Hello, welcome to the show.
Magic.
Who am I speaking to?
Magic.
I'm talking to Magic?
This is Matt. No, I'm just playing. Hey, how you guys doing?
We're good. How are you doing, Matt?
I'm doing fabulous. Oh, it's a fabulous day. So I it's not that I don't believe in resolutions, but me and my wife were actually just talking about this earlier. I just don't see the point sometimes in why people even waste the time in trying to make it if you know in 2 weeks that you're not going to stick to it. I think a resolution should be something that, to me, that's a life goal. You know, it's not something that, oh, in 6 months I get to stop it when Easter comes. You know, I think honestly a resolution should be something that you're going to stick through. But otherwise, what's the point? You know, oh, I'm going to quit drinking soda. That's my resolution. I'm going to quit drinking soda. You see what I'm saying? Like what does that really do for me? Because I know the second I go out, I'm at a friend's house, all they have to drink is soda. Well, you know, I'm not going to get water. I'm lazy. I'm going to go to the fridge and I'm going to grab soda. But that's
you
me.
Know, this
I, you
is
know,
interesting.
That's me. I can't really speak for other people. That's me. And I'd like to think that other people are kind of like me, though. You know, it's one of those things. It's it's my resolution. You know, sorry, dude. You got a cup though? I can get some water. Nobody wants to drink Vancouver's finest.
You know, we actually were talking about this the other day, and we actually, in talking about the show, we actually talked about this. Is that, you know, how many people really stick to the resolutions that they make, and.
Yeah.
I think we came up with a solution, or one, is maybe if you tell, like, a whole bunch of people so you have some sort of accountability and someone to hold you to that resolution, maybe that's the answer. I don't know. What do you think?
Well, I actually have some tips that I'm going to read, but what I want to go ahead and do is grab the other caller that's on and have them join the fun. So if you just give me a second, I'm going to go ahead and welcome them on to the show. Hello, welcome to the show. Who am I...
Hello?
Hello.
This is Danny Francis.
Hey!
Oh my God!
Is this Lisa?
Yes!
Hello, baby!
Hey!
Hey, Danny!
How are you?
I'm doing
good.
We got great. Is that Danielle Stramera over there?
No, she's a call, but she hasn't called yet, so we're waiting.
She said she was going to call in. I saw it on Facebook, so I said, I better jump on this.
You know, let's everybody just say their name for Danny, okay? Hi, Danny. My name's Robin.
I'm Lisa.
Hi, Robin. Is this Robin Sings?
This
yep.
is Robin Sings, yes.
Yep.
I know Robin. I know Miss Robin Sings.
And this is Shadow Lady.
Hi, Danny. Anthony. It's Jaden Black.
Hi.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year, love. How are you?
Great, thanks.
So how was your year, Danny? What kind of things did you get to enjoy, or what kind of things do you look back over the year and that you really enjoyed this year? Can you share anything good with us?
Last 2 months, I did a blazing trail through the U.S. doing a bunch of QR and AJ Fredo stuff and kind of rediscovering some stuff and getting to know some Rikers that I don't normally see off of Facebook on the East Coast. And
nice.
It's been a trailblazing last 2 months. So.
Any interesting places that you went to?
Yeah, we spent 2 weeks in Wales.
Oh, nice.
Very cool. In the middle of October. So, and back and forth on the Pacific Northwest, the Washington back, and pretty much that's about it.
Is there anything interesting that you learned in Wales that you didn't know before going?
England is beautiful, but this is our third trip to the UK, and my favorite spot so far is Scotland. So
okay.
We did Southwest Wales, Irish, Ireland, which is beautiful, which is probably of all the trips the most beautiful. And then we did Scotland. We got stuck over there during the Iceland volcano last year.
Uh-oh.
So we actually spent almost a month there, which is great. And then we went to Wales, and Wales was okay, but I would go back and conquer Scotland again.
Nice. We're going to talk about a little Scotland, history a little bit later with Auld Lang Syne.
Yeah.
You know, that is a Scottish poem. But anyway, that's interesting, huh?
Yeah, cool. That's really cool that you got to do that stuff. That's awesome. I speaking of Danielle, I believe she's on the line here, so shall we grab her up and get her in the conversation?
Oh, boy, we got a party line going.
Yeah.
Everybody
party,
got their
bring
party
a friend.
Line.
All right, here we go.
Everyone?
Oh, there we go.
Can you hear me?
Welcome to the show. Is this
no.
Danielle?
Hello. Hello.
Hey, Danielle.
Oh, hey.
Welcome back to the show. I'm so excited.
We need the popping of the cork here, Shadow, I think.
That's one sound bite I don't have. Here, let's do this. What's not going to play? Come on.
That sounds like a few shows I've been to.
That was a sound bite she took from a bar on the corner somewhere in Cleveland, right?
That's right. I was partying it up earlier. Yeah. So wasted. Just kidding. So how are you doing tonight, Danielle? I know there was a little... People thought that the show was Sunday because I almost always have it on a Sunday.
Right. I'm so glad you reminded me this morning because I would have just not have called in and that would have sucked. But everything's great. Yeah. Just FYI, my little boy is desperately trying to at least say hello on the radio tonight. So, and he's running back and forth from my room listening to the computer.
Put him on. Let's say hello to him.
Hey, boy.
What's his name? Does anybody know his name?
Hey, boy.
His name is Alexander. Oh, okay. Hold on. I'm going to let him talk. Don't embarrass me.
Hello.
Hi, Alexander.
Hi.
How are you?
Alexander, this is your big shot on the radio. Okay. Now,
right.
Did you have a good Christmas?
Yeah.
What was your
and I also
what?
Celebrate Hanukkah. And
Very cool.
Can you tell us a little bit about Hanukkah?
Yeah. It is a Jewish holiday that's celebrated all around December each year. It's in a different
in a different place.
Uh-huh.
This year it was started on the 20th, on the 28th. It's a crazy night.
Did you have lots of fun?
Yes, yes it is. I would get all I got was a few Legos, a model rocket, a fin alignment kit, a word find, and a helium balloon with a motor on it, an air swimmer.
Wow!
It's a shark.
Happy Hanukkah!
Very cool.
The air swimmer is
nice.
A shark with a working tail fin and a two channel thing. It's full of helium. Pretty cool.
Oh.
Alexander,
do you know what a New Year's resolution is?
Yes, I do.
I was about to ask him that.
Okay.
I know what a New Year's resolution is. Yeah,
do you know what
one this year?
What would you like to have next year be?
Is to not blow all my money on Legos and to save up.
Very good.
Because I'm trying to buy an RC plane, an expense, $109 three channel.
That's a good goal.
My mom gave me a New Year's resolution that I'm not going to follow. It's stop eating fast food.
That's what I'm talking about.
And I'm not fat. My mom shouldn't worry about me getting fat.
Alexander, maybe you can just cut back. What do you think?
Yeah, cutting back. That's what I'm planning on doing.
Okay.
Good. That's still good. That's good.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe having more fruits, vegetables, and salads, things like that.
I eat a lot of vegetables. We had tomato and rice soup tonight.
Mmm.
Isn't he a doll?
Yeah.
Oh, you're just a doll.
Well, that was very cool of you to share that with us, and I'm really excited that you got to be on the show.
Yeah, it's my first time.
Yes, it is.
Well, you be sure to call us again sometime, okay?
Right. Have your mom put you on the phone again, because we had fun talking to you.
Okay, bye. My mom got back from the other room.
Listening to you.
From listening to me. Oh, no. My mom heard me.
Okay.
Well, I'm back
to the other video, so
hold on. Oh, bye.
Bye. Thanks for talking.
Bye, Alexander.
You have a great day.
Yeah, you can call up on your phone, too, but you don't need to be on for the whole show. Thanks. Go away now. At least he's honest, you know. I'm not going to do this resolution, but no, I agree that a New Year's resolution should be something that you do all the time, that you should be able to start it on the first of the week instead of the first of the year.
Right.
Because
it should be life-change, right?
Exactly.
That's
if you're really wanting to do it, then you can do it anytime, not just
exactly.
The beginning of the year.
Maybe
it's
those things that we put off, you know. Well, you know, and so we need that marker. We need that New Year marker to say, no, by January 1st, I'm going to quit smoking, or by January 1st, you know, maybe people need that. What do you guys think?
I think that's very true, because people need a definite. And to say, okay, I will finally. But everyone's different, you know. Thank God for it. So, okay.
Well, I have five clever ways to keep your resolutions. And if you don't even want to refer to them as a resolution, maybe just life changes, right?
I might need those, so go ahead.
Okay. Number one is tell your social network. Make yourself accountable for your goals by exposing them to your social networks like Facebook or maybe Twitter. Tell your friends let your friends know your goals, what they are, and how you plan to achieve them. If you want to lose weight, for example, update your status and say, this year I plan to lose 15 pounds by exercising 3 times a week. Number 2 is blackout time and set reminders. If your resolutions require that you set time aside, like going to the gym, take advantage of your smartphone's calendar and schedule time in advance. This way, you'll be less likely to skip out on your commitments when someone asks you to make conflicting plans. Then break each resolution down into smaller steps and use your smartphone. Or if you're like me and you don't have a smartphone, maybe use a calendar or good old-fashioned paper and pen and set reminders or due dates for those mini goals. By doing so, you make your resolutions seem more achievable, and due dates will encourage you to stay committed. The third one is look into dedicated gadgets. After a few weeks, when you've established good habits and deemed your resolution realistic, consider rewarding yourself with a dedicated gadget that will help you achieve the goal. For example, if you're resolving to read more, an e-reader like maybe a Nook or a Kindle can motivate you to stock up on more books. Likewise, a Fitbit or Adidas Mi Coach are a couple of affordable devices that can help you manage fitness and weight loss in a fun way. So, you know, maybe it's something like doing fitness on the Wii. You know, there's different programs and games and such that help you to do that. I know at one point I did try that out on the Wii Fit, and, you know, I lost 11 pounds in like 2 weeks. I thought that was pretty good. Of course, I ended up canning it, but, you know, it is something that can help you.
Discipline.
Because they have a built-in calendar, and it shows you what your progress is. It's really neat. Another one is number 4, find a community. It's easy to feel discouraged when you're pursuing something alone, but with the Internet and its bountiful communities, there's no reason to tackle your resolutions in isolation. If you want to read more books, join a website like Goodreads. Or if it's a weight loss goal, check out places like Spark People and Calorie Count. Even if these aren't your friends in real life, observing their progress and exchanging advice will keep you feeling positive about all the hard work that you're doing. Alternately, start your own community by creating a Facebook group maybe. Give it a fun name and invite friends and their friends to join the group. Not only will you hold each other accountable and swap tips, but you yourself will also be more motivated by being the group leader and spearheading the cause. And then finally, 5, start a blog. Since people who keep a weight loss journal are twice as likely to shed pounds than others, try using a blog to further your goals. If the goal is to lose weight or perhaps to stay on budget, the blog will help you monitor progress and hold you accountable for what you did or didn't do. If your goal is project related, like, oh, taking a photo each day or something, maybe going and visiting a friend once a week, something like that, use the blog to post what you've produced. For example, many Tumblr blogs are dedicated to the 365-day photo challenge, which requires you to post one photo per day. Otherwise, if your goal is lifestyle-oriented, use the blog to reflect on your daily progress and use the notes to evaluate what you could do to improve or simply to bask in the glory of your successes. With these measures in place, you may end up joining the small group of people who successfully follow through with their New Year's resolutions. When the goal planning is complete, your final task is simply to just do it. So I think those are all good ideas.
Again, it relates back to accountability and discipline.
Exactly. And keeping people involved in it, because let's be honest, if it was just us, we'd just give up. So it is important to do that. And the support of others really does help. I find sometimes, though, in the reverse, sometimes when you tell everybody you're going to do something, then if you don't do it, you feel even more embarrassed. Then you get discouraged and frustrated even more. So it can kind of go both ways, depending on the kind of person you are.
You know, normally if I put my word out there and I say I'm going to do something and I make myself accountable, then I'll do it. Because, you know, I put it out there. You know, you can't... For me, that's how it works for me. If I say, you know, hey, you know, I mean, I don't like going back and saying, well, I didn't do it. I don't know. Maybe I think I need that accountability, too, and it pushes me, I think.
I agree. Well, we have another caller waiting, so let's go ahead and get them in on the line, too.
Hello.
All right, here we go. Hello, welcome.
Hello.
Hello, it's me again.
Hi.
Hey, Alexander again.
It's Alexander again. Hi, Alexander.
Hey.
Hey.
Mom doesn't okay. care if I get on.
Yeah, she does.
Right, Mom.
I'm going to beat you, child.
Uh-oh. No, I must go. Oh, I'm
okay.
in the office, so I don't think she knows where I am. Uh-oh.
Okay. I'm going to go kill him.
Excuse me. So is everybody of the opinion, like Matt, where they don't really feel like they need to set a resolution, that it's just something that you do on a daily basis? You make a decision and just go for it that way? Anybody?
Is anybody else there besides Robin and I and Danielle?
I'm here.
I'm here.
Everybody's got so quiet.
You know,
you're just waiting for the screams of my child in the background as I beat the
We're waiting. We're waiting for sirens. No, I'm kidding.
Well, I just told him he can't just blah, blah, blah. Hi! Welcome to my
911, what's your emergency? Sorry. I had to do that.
Well, we have this.
With what Robin just said, it's a daily thing. That's more how I do it. I don't really set, you know, certain resolutions. I just really try to focus on everything that I need to do every day, you know, day by day, and improve everything, improve myself inside and out, you know, and things in my life. And this also brings me to a point where I think, especially, I know Robin studies spiritual a lot, and I think that it's really important for spiritual cleansing and spiritual guidance. And so you might want to name some, spiritual leaders and books and so forth for people to, you know, check out so that it will help us on the, you know, spiritual. You know what I'm saying.
Is that a question? Well, yeah, I think all of those. Did we lose Danny?
I think we did lose Danny. Danny, are you still with us?
Yeah, I'm
Hello?
Still with you guys. I'm still
Not
with you, guys.
You, Alexander. They're asking Danny if she's there.
Oh.
Come on now. Just be quiet, you.
I think we lost Danny. Well, Danny, if you're out there, please call us back. I don't know what happened there, but I did notice we were missing one.
Come into the light.
Come here to me.
The serenity in the light.
So all of those things,
call
though.
Us back.
For me, though, you know, are you there, Matt? Because I really wanted to touch on that subject again that Matt had. Are you with us, Matt?
Oh, definitely. I'm still here with you.
Oh, okay. So you were saying that you don't really set a resolution because why? You know, and I think a lot of people feel that way. They're like, you know, I'm pretty fine the way I am. I'm living day to day. I'm doing what I can. If I need to change something, I change it. You know, why does it have to be this monumental thing that we have to do?
I think the word resolution should just be pretty much, it's another word for life goal. You know what I mean? And that's why I think, like me, I do have a resolution, quote unquote, you know what I mean? But at the same time, to me, it's a more of a life goal. Like, I want to be a better person. You know what I mean? Like I know deep inside I'm a selfish person. You know, I don't think a lot of people's opinions can match up to mine because I believe differently than a lot of people. Like, I don't believe that I should be told how to think upon how I should think. You know, if I think something's wrong, I don't want to be told that I'm wrong for thinking I'm wrong. But at the same time, I know that it is wrong in certain perspectives, you know. And so my resolution is to be more open-minded, you know, to be more acceptance, you know, to other people in that perspective. And to me, I don't really see that as a resolution, as more of a life goal. You know, I want to grow up. I'm 28 years old. And, you know, I need to quit acting like I'm freaking, you know, just turning 21 at a point. You know what I mean? And I feel like some people, they underestimate the point of what a resolution really is supposed to be. And I think that's where it's at, you know. Like I said, like, sometimes people think it's more of a joke, like, and no offense, like, you know, I'm not trying to pull anything up, but the fast food, you know, it reminds me, a lot of people do, I'm not going to have fast food. Really? That's a resolution, you know, because you know you're going to break it, you know. It's like, I'm going to cut back on fast food. Okay, that's something you could see. I could see you doing it, you know. I'm going to order a salad instead of a cheeseburger. You know, like that, I just don't see people, it's a joke, you know, and however you look at it, you could look in religious perspectives, you could look into it more of a political perspective.
So basically what you're saying is your belief is that generally you don't really change anything by making a statement, you don't really change anything unless you really want to change it.
Pretty much.
So to make a resolution is ludicrous to you. Is that what you're saying?
It's almost like an empty promise. Like, oh, I'm going to, you know, oh, we're going to go have dinner tomorrow. Almost, you know, in that aspect, you know. It's like, if you don't know, because nobody knows what the future is going to bring. I don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. You know, I could say right now, I want to quit smoking cigarettes. But say, come tomorrow, I just have the worst day of the week. It's bottomed out. I feel rock bottom. Guaranteed, I'm going to go for a cigarette, you know, and that's going to, because it's going to be my fallback. What did I just do? What did I prove? You know, and it's kind of like what you said earlier, or whoever said earlier, it's, you're disappointed, you know, and then you start feeling more of that shame because you just told everybody around you, I'm going to quit this.
Yeah, see,
and
that
now
was,
you just,
I was trying to make
it, you're back on it.
Yeah, exactly. That's the other side of it. The other side where sometimes it's better to keep it to yourself and then shock people when you've gone and done something. You know, like, for example, somebody who doesn't always see a lot of their different family members and friends, they drop, say, 50 pounds, and then they show up at the next gathering, and they're super thin and in shape, and then everyone's like, whoa, you look good. What do you do? You know, that sometimes is better for some people. Not everyone. I'm not speaking for everybody. But I think some people work better that way, where they do it in their own time and space, and there's nobody there to nag them or judge them. Do you see what I'm saying, Matt?
Oh, definitely, definitely, exactly. And it's and people are, and it'll actually, you're lying to yourself, you know? So really, are you happy when you're lying to yourself? You know what I mean?
Well, you're either ready or you're not. It's setting your mind. I mean, people can do amazing things if they put their minds to it. But if you're not truly sincere in your goal, you're not going to do it. You're just going to say, oh, another disappointment.
Well, you know, maybe sometime you do need to confide in a friend or family member, you know, in order to make that goal come into fruition. I mean, you know, and maybe I wouldn't say that resolutions are bad, but because I think in each one of us, we have a desire to change things about ourselves, you know. Maybe even if it is, you know, something really personal that we don't really want to share. I know that we all have things that we want to change. So I don't think it's bad to have a hope or to set a goal. Because if we're never setting goals, then we're always making excuses. Maybe the resolution provides us a place to where we can say, you know what, this is what I kind of really want for this year.
Mm-hmm.
And putting it out there. I don't think there's anything wrong with that.
So
and
I'm not saying,
you know,
there's anything wrong with it, Rob.
Maybe we just have to be a little bit more. No, I'm just being devil's advocate.
But we're just saying we're kind of looking at
both sides
of it. Maybe
we can just be a little bit more loose with it and not make it so seriously. Like, this is
right.
The thing that I want. This is where I have to put my attention. And, you know, but I'll tell you, but come next year, if some of the resolutions I make this year, I want to see them come to pass. Because, you know, this year I think I'm really making a commitment towards some of the resolutions or things that I want to change. And so I'm looking forward to next year. And I don't know if I'm going to share anything. I don't know that I'm going to share any of my resolutions. But this year I'm really kind of serious about it. Normally I'm not. You know? What
right.
do you think, Denise? Are there actual things that you really are looking forward to the new year that you've actually put your mind on to really change?
Me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, but mine is,
I'm saying it's spiritual. I really want to be more positive. You see, sometimes I'm so stressed out, I'm so negative, and I'm just, I want a better life, you know, for myself and for my girls, and I just want happiness and peace and love.
Yes.
And I want everything. I want the damn package. I'm tired of it, you know.
Well,
struggled for a long time.
And you know, when you and I've talked about this, that the only real way to get that is to have it from within. Until you have an inner peace in yourself, then all that positive stuff will not come to you. Remember, we've had this discussion before. I mean, I'm not going to get all spacey on you and get all spiritual and start
meditating on it, but you need
to feel good about yourself. And sometimes I think it starts inside. You know, it's not what you look like necessarily. I mean, I know we talk about losing weight. Maybe someone wants to style their hair differently and get a new change. Like, some people like to change their entire look in a new year. It's really what's inside, because when you feel good about yourself and who you are and what you're doing with your life, it just comes out in your face, and you exude happiness and calmness and positive energy. So I think what you're saying, Denise, you know, we were talking about the whole spiritual end, you know, and also for people that are Christian and believe in God, you know, sometimes it's getting closer to God and your faith or whatever it might be, whatever you believe, getting in touch with that, you know, and focusing on the good things and trying to let the bad go. And that's hard to do, you know, when you have people trying to drag you down or people that, you know, for whatever reason want to sling mug at you or whatever they might be doing. You just have to let it go. I used to think about it this way. Think about your back having a bunch of slippery oil on it, and just let it slide right off your back, you know, and sit there and list off. You know, it's really positive to do. I think Oprah Winfrey had it on one of her shows. She told you to have, like, a book where you wrote down all the things you're grateful for. I forget what she called it. I don't know if any of you online here remember what I'm talking about, but it's so important to focus on those things. You know, Denise, you know, I know you want a car and you want to live in a different place right now and you know, things going on in your life personally that you'd like to change. But you got to think about the good things. You know, you've got your health. You've got people who love you. You know,
Denise, I will make a commitment to you on the air to call you once a week to support you in feeling better. And we'll get together once a week on the phone to get together to just, you know, whether it is talking, whether it is just encouraging one another. I want to make that commitment to you on the air that I will do that.
I love you, girl. That's why you're my BFF.
Whether or not we text, because, you know, in a lot of times, too, we get so caught up in everything that is wrong with us or going on with us. And really, that's another one of my resolutions this year is my focus is a lot on me. I don't have children. You know, I don't have, you know, a lot of family around me. So a lot of my time is spent in introspection or, you know, worrying about my life or what I'm doing. And so one of my goals this year is just to kind of hook up with people and, you know, maybe encourage their dreams, maybe encourage them in the things that they're thinking about. And so, you know, Denise, you have that commitment to me. I really want to do that for you.
Yeah,
and
I'm going to go ahead.
People out there, you know, it is tough times. You know, it is.
Yeah,
really
and
tough.
That's,
but
when
really
we talk,
get together,
being there for each other, Robin.
That you love. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
I mean
that's
you gotta
important.
You got to stay close to the people that you care about. You
yeah,
really
and love. I promise too, Denise, that I know a lot of times we get lax about, you know, calling each other or catching up and. You know, I think we need to talk more often. And it's not just with Denise. It's with other people that are online here and people that might be listening that haven't called in. You know, I make a promise that if you want to call that a resolution, whatever you want to call it, just as Robin said, I make a promise that I'm going to try to be there more often, no matter what's going on in my life, even if it's a 5-10-minute call.
Absolutely.
Well, it looks like we got another caller, speaking about keeping in touch. So I'm going to go ahead and answer. I know exactly who this is, and I'm really excited to get them back on the line here. Welcome to the show. Is this Cherie?
Yay!
It is.
Yay!
Yay!
Hi, Cherie!
Hey!
Yay, girl!
Robin,
can we get the applause, please? The applause.
All right, are we ready? We got a little applause going.
All for me, yay. No, I'm kidding.
We love you, baby. We love you.
Thank you. Love y'all, too.
So what have you been thinking about for this coming year? Have you set any resolutions? Do you believe in them? Do you not believe in them? What's on your mind?
I don't stick to them like I should, but it's right now it's the usual fat girl. I got to do something to get fat. That's all I got to say. So that's one of my main, and that's something that I'm really going to stick to this year because I'm very, very, very unhealthy right now. So that's one of the things. I'm just going to spend more time on myself, taking care of myself. I don't ever go to the doctor, or I don't ever do this, I don't ever do that. And there's problems with me that I need to, you know, have looked at, checked out and everything. And it's about time that I stop and actually take care of myself. So,
well,
that's
good. I think that's a good goal. Absolutely. I think that's a great goal.
Yes, definitely. And but keep in mind, this is something that anybody who wants to lose weight, think of it as just getting healthier. Because the healthier
right.
you are, the more you can live your life the way you want to. There's nothing worse than not being healthy. And I've had some health issues here and there, and I know exactly how it feels. You know, when you're a kid, you take it for granted because most kids are healthy. And they think, oh, you know, when they hear the older people complaining, oh, they've got this ache and pain, whatever it might be. You don't realize how important health is. If you don't have health, you don't have a life. I mean, let's be honest. If you're not healthy, you can't do the things you want to do. You can't get out. You're not even, you know, up to even sometimes having a good talk. So think of it that way, that you're going to get as healthy as you can. And, I mean, I have no doubt you can do it. You definitely have a really strong spirit, and I wish you well with that. And we will be here for you. You know, if you want us to help you.
Absolutely. You guys have been such great therapy for me this year. It's not even funny. So, you know, I am so grateful. I am so grateful for you guys. And, you know, I love you guys to death. Never even met you before. But, you know, some I have met now and everything. You're just a great, great bunch of people, and I just love y'all.
Well,
and
we love you too.
Because
I'm
from the South. So.
Well, I
know.
Think
we need
to share
you
back. I'm sorry.
I think we need
Danielle
the Sherry applause again. I was good.
No, I'm still here.
Okay.
I've been
Well,
I
you
just
spent the pleasure of. I'm sorry. We keep overlapping. I just wanted to say you've had the pleasure of meeting Sherry. I'm jealous.
Oh, God. She is
And I'm
so
jealous
so
she met
wonderful.
You.
Danielle!
I love you, baby.
I love you, too. I know that voice.
See,
I love you, too.
Here.
Sorry. We're a little silly.
But it would be cool if
Alabama Slammer.
But we want to go ahead and extend an invitation to those listening on Facebook. If you're listening on Facebook and not particularly in chat, you can also call in. If you want to have, if you have something on your mind about the coming new year, or something that you want to say, or maybe raise a topic, the number is 424-243-9676. Call now.
Well, while I'm still on the topic of the whole New Year resolution thing, I have a little information here about how New Year's resolutions got their start. So, if you guys want to hear about it, I'll go ahead and share that.
Okay, and I know there are several cultures that do it, that have celebrated that. But go ahead. I don't know how it started.
Okay. The tradition of New Year's resolutions goes all the way back to 153 B.C. Janus. I'm not sure how to pronounce it. I'm just going to say Janus. A mythical king of early Rome was placed at the head of the calendar. With two faces, Janus could look back at past events and forward to the future. Janus became the ancient symbol for resolutions, and many Romans looked for forgiveness from their enemies and also exchanged gifts before the beginning of the year. The new year has not always been on January 1st, and it doesn't begin on the date everywhere today. It begins on that date only for cultures that use the 365-day calendar, solar calendar. January 1st became the beginning of the new year in 46 BC when Julius Caesar developed a calendar that would more accurately reflect the seasons that the previous calendars had. The Romans named the first month of the year after Janus, which is January, so it would be Janus, the god of beginnings and the guardian of doors and entrances. He was also depicted with two faces, one on the front of his head and one on the back. He sounds two-faced. Thus, he could look backward and forward at the same time. At midnight on December 31st, the Romans imagined Janus looking back at the old year and forward to the new. The Romans began a tradition of exchanging gifts on New Year's Eve by giving one another branches from sacred trees for good fortune. Later, nuts or coins imprinted with the god Janus became more common New Year gifts. In the Middle Ages, Christians changed New Year's Day to December 25th, the birth of Jesus. Then they changed it to March 25th, a holiday called the Annunciation. In the 16th century, Pope Gregory the 13th revisited the Julian calendar, and the celebration of the new year was returned to January 1st. The Julian and Gregorian calendars are solar calendars. Some cultures have lunar calendars, however. A year in a lunar calendar is less than 365 days because the months are based on the phases of the moon. The Chinese use the lunar calendar. Their new year begins at the time of the first moon over the Far East after the sun enters Aquarius, sometime between January 19th and February 21st. Although the date for New Year's Day is not the same in every culture, it's always a time for celebration and for customs to ensure good luck in the coming year. So that's pretty interesting.
Yeah.
How it kind of is a little different in different places. I guess we just kind of assume that everybody celebrates at the same time, but that's not true.
Right. Just on different time zones.
That too. We use, they're just 3 hours ahead of us. Oh, they're 5 or 6 hours ahead of us or behind us.
Yeah. So how are we going to do that tomorrow night? we're going to celebrate it on Eastern time, right? Because that's the right time, right?
Central time.
No, Eastern.
Excuse me.
Oh, ma'am. I said Eastern. That means it's Eastern.
Okay. Whatever you say, Danielle.
Whatever.
You know, there is a way to increase your good fortune, they say. You know, during with the coming new year, there is a way to increase your fortune. Does everybody know what that is?
No,
nobody's heard of the New Year's cake where they hide the coin in it, or maybe.
You're talking about like Mardi Gras, like the king cake.
Yeah. Well, also too. Yeah. Well, in New Year's, revelers in Spain, they consume 12 grapes at midnight. So what they do is eat one grape for each stroke of the clock. And that dates back to like the early 1900s, when the grape growers over there, they initiated the practice to take care of the grapes surplus that was over there. So what they do is, and then it ended up the idea over there, it stuck. And it spread to Portugal as well as, you know, Venezuela, Cuba, Mexico, Ecuador, and Peru. What they do is each grape represents a month. So, for instance, the third grape is a bit sour. It means that March will be like a rocky month. Or something. So they have that tradition. They'll get like 12 grapes and, you know, they'll consume 12 grapes each grape at midnight, you know. So each grape for each stroke of the clock. Yeah.
Huh.
Yeah.
That's
so the goal is to swallow all the grapes before the last stroke of midnight.
But well, as you know, in the U.S., it was custom to kiss at midnight, to share a kiss at midnight when it strikes 12. It's derived from masked balls that have been common through history. As tradition has
it. Really? I didn't know that.
Yeah, the mask symbolized evil spirits from the old year, and the kiss is the purification into the new year. So we're kissing away all the negativity and the evil spirits.
Wow. Guess everybody should find somebody to kiss them.
Yeah.
Man, I'm going to be kissing a lot.
Just kiss everybody.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
Walk down the street and just grab a stranger.
Exactly.
We're kissing away the evil spirits. Let's go. Yeah, I've got a list here of all different traditions. It's pretty cool. It's amazing how different everybody is in the different areas. Would you like to hear them?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. It says, good luck traditions. With the New Year's upon us, here's a look at some of the good luck rituals from around the world. They are believed to bring good fortune and prosperity in the coming year. For Austria, the suckling pig is a symbol for good luck for the new year. It's served on a table decorated with tiny edible pigs. Dessert often consists of green peppermint ice cream in the shape of a four-leaf clover. So that's
how I don't think we can do that here, though. I mean, can anybody go to Whole Foods and get a suckling pig? Can you even get those anywhere in the U.S.?
I have seven in my backyard.
I guess we're going to Danielle's house.
We're going to Danielle's for a suckling pig we're from Austria. I can't even talk. Okay, and then the next one is England. The British place their fortunes for the coming year in the hands of their first guest. They believe the first visitor of each year should be male and bearing gifts. Traditional gifts are coal for the fire, a loaf for the table, and drink for the master. For good luck, the guests should enter through the front door and leave through the back. Guests who are empty-handed or unwanted are not allowed to enter first. Unwanted? That's not nice.
Can you say that again, please?
Okay, take two. Wait, we got the rewind sound. Here we go. Where is it? I'm going to rewind. This sound is for when people are having problems talking. There you go.
I will go off every time I speak.
All right, I'm going to try this again. Okay. All right, the last sentence was, guests who are empty-handed or unwanted are not allowed to enter first. But, okay, I did it. Okay.
And unwanted.
Wales, at the first toll of midnight, the back door is opened and then shut to release the old year and lock out all of its bad luck. Then at the 12th stroke of the clock, the front door is opened and the new year is welcomed in with all of its good luck. Wow.
I love other cultures. I'm sorry. I do. They have all this neat stuff.
It's still like a gift, though. In Haiti, New Year's Day is a sign of the year to come. Haitians wear new clothing and exchange gifts in the hope that it will bode well for the new year. So I guess giving gifts and wearing really cool clothes, they think that's
the Americans, we just drink, pretty much.
Yeah, we drink and kiss. And we cry about how lonely we are if we don't have someone to kiss. Sicily. An old Sicilian tradition says good luck will come to those who eat lasagna on New Year's Day. If you dine on macaroni for any other noodle will bring on bad luck. So
lasagna.
I'm going to eat some lasagna.
What was that?
Hello?
What was that?
I said Garfield would agree with that.
Oh, man, I said that.
Okay, Spain. In Spain, when the clock strikes midnight, the Spanish eat 12 grapes. This is what you were talking about. One for every toll, I guess, would be month to bring good luck for the 12 months ahead.
I'm doing that this year. I'm doing it. Grapes
and
lime.
Do it, girl. And then I want to know what you find out. Peru. The Peruvian New Year's custom is a spin on the Spanish tradition of eating 12 grapes. They do the same thing in the turn of the new century. But in Peru, a 13th grape must be eaten to assure good luck.
Oh. So I wonder if I should do it the Peruvian way.
Maybe add a little extra, the 13th. Some people think 13 is a lucky number, so my dad always did. Greece. A special New Year's bread is baked with a coin buried in the dough. The first slice is for the Christ child, the second for the father of the household, and the third slice is for the house. If the third slice holds the coin, spring will come early that year. That's kind of like the whole groundhog thing.
Yeah.
Right?
If anybody wants a recipe for the grease cake for the New Year's orange and brandy cake, hit me up on Facebook or I'll go ahead and post it up on Facebook. It's a really good cake. But be careful hiding the coin because, you don't want anybody to choke on it. So maybe you can maybe use a poker chip or something like that.
Or if you use a little baby Jesus.
You can't use a poker chip because you're baking it, I guess.
I guess they stick it in after. I don't know. Actually, Denise, is there. Denise and another friend of ours, actually for one of my birthdays, they sent me like a Mardi Gras cake, king cake it's called, and there was a little gold baby Jesus, and I almost bit my tooth off. But thank you for the cake, Denise. That was years ago. You remember that, Denise?
Okay. I'll never forget it. That was so much fun when we did that for you.
I still have necklaces and a little like clown doll and cup and stuff.
Well, I want to make the cake, but I'm afraid somebody's going to, you know, my ear neighbor, you know, my neighbor's going to choke on a coin. But I want to do it anyway.
Tell them to nibble lightly or break it with their hands, right?
Smash it with a fork before eating.
There you go.
Matt, you and Carly got to come over for some cake.
Okay. Now, the Japanese, they decorate their home in tribute to the lucky gods. One tradition, Kodomatsu, I'm sorry if I'm butchering that, consists of a pine branch symbolizing longevity, a bamboo stalk symbolizing prosperity, and a plum blossom showing nobility. And then on China's end, for the Chinese New Year, every front door is adorned with a fresh coat of red paint, red being a symbol of good luck and happiness. Although the whole family prepares a feast for the New Year, all knives are put away for 24 hours to keep anyone from cutting themselves, which is thought to cut the family's good luck for the next year. Wow. That's crazy. They would cut themselves for the New Year. That doesn't sound good.
No, they don't want to cut themselves, so they would put the knife. You know, if you're like, oh, here, let me cut this up, and then you cut yourself, it's bad luck.
No one ever thinks
of that. So they have to put all the knives away.
But the red door thing, I mean, I painted my house with a red door just because I thought it looked nice. Yeah, the Chinese would have thought that was awesome.
Yeah, was it in January?
No, it wasn't.
Then it probably wasn't.
Yeah, I mean, it was. I'm trying to think when I was painting the house. Yeah, it might have been January. Hey, I was celebrating the Chinese New Year without knowing it. Okay, and then another one we have is Norway. Norwegians make rice pudding at New Year's and hide one whole almond within. Guaranteed wealth goes to the person whose serving holds that lucky almond.
See, all these are choking hazards.
That's a cool one, though.
Yeah, but if you know there's an almond in there, you're just going to munch, you know? You're going to be careful. Because there's almonds and other things, you know, like walnuts and stuff when you have, like, banana walnut bread. You expect there's going to be one in there.
Well, just celebrate New Year, but know the Heimlich. What I'm saying.
Choking up a poor baby Jesus. Come on now. That's just
how
wrong.
Many deaths were caused for New Year's, right? How many people died on New Year's due to these choking hazards?
That would be a good statistic to find out.
Yeah, I would wonder how we would find that out.
We'll give that one to you, Danielle. You can look that
up.
Yeah,
you research that and get back to us.
You got it. Yeah.
How many people choke on a coin or almond during New Year's? Yeah.
Inquiring minds want to know. Dun, dun, dun.
No.
Na, 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 na.
Okay, let's just stop that now while
I hear. Is desperately trying to get back on the line so he can say goodnight to everyone.
Are you talking to Danny?
Oh, what the heck.
You what?
Were you talking about Danny trying to get back on?
No, Alexander wants to
Alexander.
Say goodnight.
Oh.
He just wants to say goodnight.
Oh, Alexander.
Okay. Are you there, Alexander?
I'm here. I can hear you.
Okay. I guess your mom says you wanted to tell us good night.
And I have one new, and I do have one resolution that I forgot to tell you, but that's going to be extremely hard to do, and I might even not do it. Come back
here.
On Martinelli's sparkling cider.
What did he say? Say it again.
Cut back on Martinelli's sparkling apple cider.
But
I
have
to be really hard. I've been hooked on it for 2 years.
Wow.
It started on New Year's and then you kept drinking it? Was it a New Year's thing?
It's going to be hard to quit, but...
Yeah.
Well, good night.
Well, Alexander, if you need...
Next time you guys get back on.
Alexander, if you need a support group, just come back next week and listen to the show, and you let us know how you're doing on cutting back, okay?
Sparkling Wine Anonymous.
Okay.
Give us a call.
Good night, Alexander.
Next show next week.
Okay.
Bye, guys.
Good night. Good night, you beautiful boy.
Good night.
Good night.
Happy
you have
New
good
Year.
Dreams.
And when
Happy
you grow
New
up,
Year.
Drink insomnia.
That's what mommy drinks.
You have a
you know, Denise, I'm going to give you a hard time
Danielle.
Because it, Denise, I'm going to give you a hard time, Jane Black. Because it's
Danielle?
Insania. But you, no,
yeah,
that
yeah,
was Jane
I
Black.
It. It's Insania.
It,
yeah,
you know,
you're right.
Yeah, it's Insania, not Insania. She gets an English accent every time she says that.
Insania? I got really, 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 really drunk on some Insania, like, last week. I mean, whew, drunker
wine.
Than ever. It is
good
a
wine.
Great wine.
Thank you, Jeff Tate. Good wine.
Thank you.
White
thank
and
you,
red.
Jeff.
I like them both.
Can I get in here? Danielle, I just wanted to say that your son is very well spoken.
Thank you.
You've done really well. He's a great kid.
I kick him
awesome.
As much as I can.
Whatever works.
<Yeah. laughs> No, he's all right. He's a pretty good egg. He just likes to be involved. But he's 10, so.
Yeah, but he's at a really good age where he's, like, learning a lot and maybe becoming more independent-minded, a little stubborn. But I think you've done really well. I think he's a great kid. And it was
well,
really cool
wonderful.
That he called him.
I think it's wonderful, too. I think I love listening to him. He's just great.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for letting him be on the show. I appreciate
intelligent.
It.
No, it was our pleasure. He was really fun to talk to.
Thank you. He's all doing skipping and stuff in the other room because he's still listening. He's going, they like me, they like me, they little jiggle, little jiggle. It's really
you know,
cute.
When my mother would put me to bed, she'd say, good night, Robin, good night, Robin, good night, Robin. It's time to go to bed. And, I mean, she'd do it over and over, you know. Okay, I'm going to bed, you know, but.
Please make it stop.
Just stop singing.
Did you have your fingers after a while?
We have two guests. I don't know who they are. Guest 10508 and guest 9989. Welcome. If you haven't heard the show before, welcome you. If anybody wants to go ahead and call in and add to the conversation, does anybody else have anything that's been on their mind tonight? Anybody? Sherry? Jaden? Lisa?
Matt?
Well, I always have a lot on my mind. The mind constantly wanders.
The mind wobbles.
I actually have a personal question, Missy. Did you send that letter off? Yes? No?
Who are you talking to?
Robin.
Talking to you.
Yes, I did. I did
yes,
get my, and I did get a response, and so I need to take care of that this week, so we'll see.
Was it a positive response?
Yeah, you know.
So. I told you it would be.
Well, without saying what it is, let's just all together wish Robin well, because there's something that she's hoping for, and I wanted to make sure that she gets it.
Robin would be very, very good at, I think, honestly. And my hopes are very high.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate it. I appreciate that. We'll see. I think we'll see. It was a job that I, just to let the listeners know, it was a job that I'm applying for. And we'll see how it goes. We'll see how it goes. So anyway,
well, the news is coming, guys. It's crazy. Are you guys ready for this? Are you guys actually ready for this 2012?
Are we ever really ready for it? I mean, like I said earlier in the show,
well,
that
hold up. Hey,
nobody really knows
for
sure what's going to happen there, and that's it's to some people that may be exciting. To me, I think it's kind of scary because you don't know.
We're talking to a skeptic.
Skeptic? Oh, I'm not a skeptic. Oh, I definitely believe something's going down, but I don't know what.
Mm-hmm.
Don't know for sure. I wish we could go and find the Mayans and talk to them. Probably they just ran out of materials to make the calendar, and we're all sitting here going, holy crap, what's going to happen? And really, it's going to be nothing.
Well, you can't do anything about it, so why stress about it?
That is true.
I'm certainly not stressed. Not about that anyway.
Well, if the planets all align that they're talking about and there's a bunch of solar flares, then we won't be talking on the computer anymore. I'll tell you that much. I hope that does not happen. I don't want our grid to fry up.
Well, that'll be like Y2K, but instead of Y2K, it's 12 years later.
Y2K plus 12.
Story out of heaven.
Like, that's why I was saying it's so important to get right with God if you're a Christian, and get right with whatever it is that you believe, and get close to your friends and family, and spend a lot of time with them, and let them know how you feel about them. Tell people you love them all the time, even if they think you're a big sap. Who cares? Because you just never know. You know, if that 2012 thing is true, this might be the last time we talk. You know, as far as talking about this, and then we may find out by next year, we don't have this chance again to talk about this conversation, you know, the New Year's thing. Maybe not. Maybe we'll have 30, 40, 50 more of them. But, you know, it's just, it teaches you something, and that's to live for the day and plan for the future, yes, but just do your best living as best and as well as you can, and just remember everybody that loves you, and make sure to let them know you love them too.
I'm a big advocate on that. That's why you see me all over Facebook. Like, I love you, because I do. I love all my friends. If I didn't have my friends, my biggest supporters and my family, but, you know, I couldn't make it through all of my days. And not everything that I go through. I need you guys, you know. I mean, Rob and Lisa have been with me for 9 years. A lot of the Rikers have been with me for, you know, 5 or 9 years. I've met a lot of them in the past year. That's been awesome, you know. I just, you know, and that's just like the right world, you know, but there's like other, of course, there's like a lot of people that I'm blessed to have in my life. And I'm a huge advocator. I love you. Well, I do, because, you know, otherwise I wouldn't make it. And, you know, sometimes people are like, oh, you say I love you too much. No, I don't. No, because I don't want to be standing at, you know, over the grave one day, God forbid, and regretting not letting that person hear me say that.
That's so true. I mean, not to get on a big downer, but it's true. I mean,
right.
We don't know. No one knows how long any of us has. You know, we don't know how long we all have. So.
At 100%. I love my friends, and if it, you know, at points, I don't know where I wouldn't be if it weren't for some of my bestest friends. You know, they have my back in places that just some people I feel can't really get to. You know, they don't have that trust, like that best friend, those really good friends, those people you know that will be honest with you and be strong with you, you know, and they'll have your back no matter what. You know, so I agree 100% with that.
Yeah, and those are some of the best friends, the ones that are honest with you. They don't whitewash, they don't sugarcoat, they tell you what it is, even if it might sting a little bit. You know that they're going to tell you the truth, and I'm that kind of person, and I respect that in my friends. So,
I respect that too. That means more to me than anything.
Even if we get mad a little bit, you know, for a little while, and then we shake it off, you know, big deal. I mean, you got to be truthful with each other.
Definitely like that. There have been so many knockouts that she's given me, like smackdowns, that I've needed them over the years. So, I mean,
well,
and
I'm glad to see that you take it the right way, but I am honest with you, and it's because I care. You know, if I didn't care, I probably wouldn't even bother. But the truth of the matter is, when you really love somebody or you really care about somebody, you know, and they ask you a question, you better be willing to answer them honestly. You know, I mean, when people ask a question, they want to be lied to. They're living a lie. You know, that's not right. So that's my way of doing things. And I appreciate and respect people that are that way. And Robin and I are both like that, you know, in our friendship, too. You know, sometimes it might, like I said, it might sting a little bit.
Well,
but
I think a lot of times, you know, you're misinterpreted, you know. And you're misinterpreted because you are so direct. But, you know, I think for the people that really, really know you, they really appreciate your honesty, appreciate your sensitivity and your passion, you know. And I don't know, I get you. What can I say? So, and I am thankful for all my friends as well. And I think sometimes we can get misunderstood, you know. A lot of times there are misunderstandings. But, you know, we just need to keep the people that we want close to us, around us, And don't let anything else bother us, you know. There's enough to worry
about
without being concerned.
Well, that's a way that you can...
Go ahead.
I'm sorry.
Oh, go ahead.
It's just a way, like, the honesty, you know, how it can sting sometimes. No, but there's a way that you can come across, you know, someone without it. You're not sugarcoating, you know, you're telling them what they need to know. But then
mm-hmm.
there's also a way you can do it to where it doesn't seem so brutal, I guess you can say.
Right. I mean, you want to still have tact. I mean, I'm not
right.
the type of person that just starts mouthing off and swearing at somebody when I'm frustrated with them. I just say, listen, do you want me to tell you the truth or do you want me to tell you what you want to hear? And, you know,
right.
a lot of people don't want to hear the truth, and that's really sad because, you know, I have gotten a lot further in my life and I've gotten further as a person inside by having people be truthful with me and say, you know, this is something you should really think about changing. You know, but if you have a bunch of friends that are just like, oh, we love you, you're the perfect, most wonderful person, and they don't tell you that maybe there's this thing about you that's a little annoying, and then you never change
right.
it because you think you're fine.
We've had a few
you think you're okay,
that,
but you don't know to change.
Right, you think you're fine. Everyone's loving you. They think you're great, and then all of a sudden,
mm-hmm.
one person is finally able to tell you the truth, and you're like, whoa, I didn't know I was irritating people, you know, and that's not just me. I mean, it's everyone. So I think it's really important, and maybe that's a New Year's resolution that we can all have, is to just be honest with people.
You know, and the thing is, too, you know, you got to always watch your reaction, you know, and, you know, sometimes you got to take a step back and take things for what they are and not react. And so that's another thing, too.
That's right. You can't control what's handed to you, but you can control how you react to it. That's so true, Robin.
Exactly. There's been many a times that I've gotten, like, really, something really got to me really, really bad. But for some reason, I just, before I reacted, I would just step back and all, and then feel silly. You know, it'll kind of calm down, then I feel silly. I was so thankful I didn't, like, act on my feelings at the time and all. And I want to try to, you know, always be that way. Because I realized that, you know, in the end, it was silly. Or,
yeah.
you know, it's something that's so trivial
yeah.
that wasn't really anything worth, you know, whatever. And I want to make sure that I continue to do that. I've been very good at that lately, and I've been proud of myself.
Yeah, something I've heard is if you're going to say something that you might regret, you know, if you think you're that angry, sometimes just give yourself a little time to think it over, because you may find that you'll have a clearer head and you won't react as much as you would just respond. There's a difference between
right.
reacting and responding. Responding
exactly.
is hearing feelings and working through it. Reacting is anger, aggression, sarcasm, whatever it may be.
Yeah.
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 And
my dad would always call that spontaneous urge to lash out or, you know,
especially when someone's hurt
or
wronged you. Yeah.
Right. My dad always says that, if you, before you say something, twist your tongue in your mouth 3 times before you say something
oh.
that will end up, you'll regret saying. And you know what? He's an ass, but he's right. So,
did you twist your tongue 3 times before you said that, Danielle?
I twist my tongue 3 times before I say that every time. And it still comes out. It's like, wow, really? Yeah, he must be. But that's okay.
How can you bite the tongue, though?
Well, I see Steve responding here in chat. I think he needs to call us up and tell us in person on the phone. What do you think?
Yeah. Steve,
come on.
Get on the phone.
Let's go.
Get on, Steve.
Get on,
that's so funny. Come on, Steve. We're going to get on you.
Come on.
I couldn't even get on chat.
So, Steve. I need you, buddy.
Yeah, we only got one guy here. It's like a bunch of chicks. Although I'm sure Matt doesn't mind that entirely. It's just he wants a man to.
That was in a nutshell. Excuse my language. I apologize for that.
He wants to know who can twist their tongue. Well, I can fold my tongue.
I can fold my tongue.
I can tie three stems in knots. Is that good?
Oh, I can too.
Oh, come on, Steve, call. No, 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 hold on. Let's go. Let's go. Come on.
Come on, Steve.
Go, Steve.
Steve, what's up? Let's go. Come on, bro. Come on.
We love you, Steve.
All right, then. Well.
Well, whenever we get
on
that, you know, don't rush or anything on our account. That's fine, Steve.
Yeah,
no, there's only, you know,
41
minutes left.
Yeah, we only got, like, about 40 minutes. You know, nope, and then whenever.
Right.
You know, maybe in the middle of the outro you can call. That'd be cool.
No passive-aggressive there, either.
See, that is just us being funny. We love you, Steve. Come on, seriously, call. Call now. Now.
Call now.
Now.
What did we tell you? Come on.
Oh, okay. I see somebody here, but it looks like they automatically showed up as they're on. What the? Oh, okay. I see what happened. They got moved. I think this might be Steve. I wonder. I feel psychic. Hi, Miss Cleo. I think that there is a call and Steve on the phone. I'm going to call in and going to answer this now, man.
Oh, boy. We've lost
Hello,
it.
Is this Steve?
A more prediction.
Hello, this is Steve. Hello. Hello.
Hello?
Oh, you got dropped. What the heck? Call back, Steve. I'm pretty sure that was you. Okay. Anyway, we'll just talk some more while we wait on Steve. What can we talk about while we wait for Steve? Let's see.
What are your plans?
I want to talk
How about
to plan?
We haven't talked about plans for New Year's, eh? Eh?
Eh?
Eh? Hey, guys.
I don't go out on New Year's.
Things, eh? How about we go play some hockey, eh?
Eh?
Danielle should have come up there for New Year's.
You come up here, baby. I'll be working until 8, and then we're going to stay home for the amateur drunks are out in a plethora of them.
Oh, my God, no kidding.
Wait,
I think Steve's back. Let's see if it works this time.
Boy, this is really sounding
like...
Are
you there, Steve? Do you hear us?
Line extraordinaire.
Come in, Steve.
Yeah.
It's Steve, everybody.
Is
Yay!
It?
Hey.
How you doing?
That was the first time.
Well, I did not boot you. I was just sitting here waiting on you. We were waiting and waiting, tapping our fingers.
That wasn't me calling.
Yes, it was. It was the same number. Either that or it's pretty close. Wait. No, it was different. Who was that? Oh, my. It's a mystery caller.
Do you dump somebody else?
I didn't dump them. They just disappeared. Maybe they got chicken and they ran away and got scared. They got stage fright. I think that's what it was.
That's
always possible.
That's probably what it is. So, Steve, we got you on the phone now. All right. So what were you saying about? You said that when you speak out right away, that reacting is what you really feel, actually, and that's not sugarcoating it. So you feel that it's better to just bark out whatever you feel immediately. Is that what you're saying?
Pretty much. It's the same theory as a drunk man's words or a sober man's thoughts. You know? It's the same kind of thing there. If it comes to mind, then more than likely that's your first thought. You sit there and give yourself time to think about it, then, you know, you sugarcoat it or you forget about it. And
yeah.
It's on the first
I can year. Call it.
But,
yeah.
You know, then again, that's why people either hate me or love me because they take it for what it's worth.
Yeah. Well, I have a tendency to be a little bit like you, Steve. You know, the times that I sit and think it through, I overthink it, and maybe I don't say some of the things I really wanted to say. And in other ways, I say things I think, should I have said that? But the truth of the matter is I'm telling the person how I feel. You know, and if they can't handle that, then there's not a whole lot I can do about it. And I'm a strong-willed person, and I, you know, I'm not a mealy-mouthed little wallpaper, you know, wallflower type of person. So If people are going to like me, they're going to like me and accept that, you know, that's just how I am. I'm not being rude intentionally or anything, but sometimes people take things wrong, too. You know, I mean, it doesn't matter how nicely you think you're choosing your words. There's always going to be someone who's going to misinterpret them.
Yep.
You know? And
it's going to take somebody off.
Of course. And, you know, I do that sometimes because I'm a very, very strong-willed person, very outspoken, very opinionated on things. I mean, I admit it. And the people who love me really, really love me. And there's some people there that really don't like me because of it. But, you know, I'm being myself. I'm not hurting anybody intentionally. If I hurt people, I truly don't mean to. So that's my take on it. But we do have the other person back that I thought was you, Steve, so let's find out who this person is, okay?
Hello?
Hello? Welcome to the show. Who are
Hello.
We talking to?
It's
who's
Renee.
Who's
Renee.
Me?
Renee.
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 Hi, Renee.
Which
Hi,
Renee?
Hi, Renee.
So many Renees.
How
are you
Robin
doing tonight, Renee?
Fine.
That's my sister, guys. Hi, Renee.
Robin's sister. Hi.
Robin's
welcome
sister.
To the show.
Thank
Who's
you.
It's my sister. Now, Renee, do you have any New Year's resolutions for next year?
No, I don't usually do New Year's resolutions just because I never stick to them.
We sound kind of related. I don't know, Renee.
Yeah.
But I at least want to accomplish
a new year.
Well, I at least want to accomplish a few this year, Renee. You got to help me.
I will. I heard you saying you were going to accomplish them, and I was like, yes, she's going to accomplish them. That's my New Year's resolution, actually, is help her accomplish one of her resolutions. How's that?
You know, I love it.
It's still productive, right? Because you're helping somebody else be productive, so that's still productive.
Yes, exactly.
There you go.
That's my main resolution this year.
Help everybody get theirs to work.
I'm going to hold you to it. I'm going to hold you to
okay.
it. So.
Okay.
I love you, dear sister.
We got this on air now, so we're all with you.
Not going back now.
So, Renee, do you have any traditions or anything that you guys do? Do you make something on New Year's, or do you do something on New Year's?
No. Years ago, when we were kids, remember, we used to make our own batch of chocolate chip cookies every New Year's Eve?
You know, I don't remember that. Really?
You don't remember that?
Here's a cookie.
Rhonda, Tomiko, and you and I, we'd all make a batch of chocolate chip cookies.
Wow.
And eat the whole thing. And I think we
I like
ate most
that
of them well before we cooked them.
I think that's a good question. Did they not share the cookies with you, Robin? Is that why you forgot?
No, I have a horrible memory.
She's got PTSD. Blocked it out.
If anybody knows me, you know, if I forget to call you, I'm sorry. If I, you know, I have a horrible memory. I just, I don't know. Buy me a memory game.
Yep.
Yeah, I can attest to that. I love you, Robin, but you do have a very forgetful mind. It's like I'm talking and then I, like, ask her a question. What? I'm sorry. What did you say? I love
you.
Yeah,
we rely
just
on our
not...
older sister to remember everything for us.
Yeah, and when I'm on the phone, I end up doing it, too.
When I was a little kid, they would say, oh, you know, that girl, she's in her own little world. And, you know, I don't know, I guess it kind of translated to adulthood a little bit. So
I think it's because you are, like, a dreamer. And I've been accused of that, too. So I think people that are dreamers have a tendency to go off and start dreaming, and then they lose things that people are saying at times.
I don't know.
That's what I think. I think it's because you're a dreamer. Let's make it a positive here. You're a dreamer, Robin.
Absolutely.
Okay, this isn't Who's Your Life, so somebody say something.
It's Robin's little area here. We're talking about Robin. Take a bow.
Which one was saying that the sister's home?
I don't know. I think it was Danielle who was saying that. And I think the reason she was saying that is because she said that if her dad would remind her that if she wasn't saying anything nice, to twist her tongue three times or twice.
Well, before
or
she
a nice thing. It was just something just
so you would think that maybe you shouldn't.
You think before you speak, right? You think before you speak, yeah.
Right.
Because you can't speak your words back, right?
Right.
And you only have one chance to have a first impression on someone, unfortunately, too.
Yeah.
I think it's important to think before you talk because you don't need to be hurtful when you do say something. If something isn't nice but needs to be said, you still need to find a positive way to say it and not be hurtful.
That's right.
Or you could just be, you know, like Steve and funny in his sarcastic, wonderful way that we all enjoy every single day on Facebook.
Hey, true.
I always get a laugh whenever, ever I am down. I can just go on Steve's page and he will make me crack up no matter what. It is true.
Who's that?
Uh-huh. Yeah, we appreciate your craziness there, Steve. We like it.
No.
We relate.
Yes, this is Sheree.
Danielle's one that actually met me and knows that, I mean, I'm somewhat like that in person, but I'm not as whacked out as what I seen on Facebook.
No.
I had a great Reich show with Steve when August 9th. Yeah, he's awesome in person, too.
You mean you didn't start barking out a bunch of quotes that are really funny?
No, in front of a lot of people.
Quiet, though.
Right, let me get back to this reserve thing, and he's there on here.
I don't know what anybody just said. Wait, we need the record scratch effect. Here we go. What was that? I'm sorry, I missed all that. I didn't get it.
What do they do? They give you sound effects now?
I have to download them myself and put them.
There was an interesting list that I ended up coming across, and I thought it was interesting. It was a top 10 New Year's resolutions. And I started reading through this list, and I thought, my gosh, this is a really good list because it's like most of the things that people mention, you know, that I don't know, maybe these are things that we don't do or something or we think that we need to do anyway, but it is a really great list. If I can share it real quick, it's really quite
go for it.
Long and tedious, I'm sorry. No, but number one is spend more time with friends and family. Number two is fit and fitness, taming the bulge, you know. Number four, quit smoking. Number five, enjoy life more. Number six, quit drinking. Yeah, some people say that.
Okay, wait a minute.
I don't really drink that much anyway.
Why don't you read them off and then everybody can give their interpretation of
that? Sounds good.
Of what they are. What was number one again?
Spend more time with family and friends.
I can hear somebody talking. Is somebody talking on another line or do they have their speaker up maybe?
I've got mine on mute.
Unless I'm
talking, I have my phone on mute, so I don't screw anything up.
I could hear somebody talking. It almost sounded like someone was on a cell phone. Okay. I'm sorry. I just wanted to make sure that we could hear Robin talking because she's got a really good list here, and I don't want to keep interrupting her. I'm sorry, Robin. Are you there?
No, it's okay. Yeah.
Do we want to play the
basically
number sound?
Yeah, basically, never mind, forget it, scrap the list. Basically, it is spend time with your family and friends, quit all your bad habits, and keep fit, and enjoy life more, and get
Amen.
Out of that.
Yay!
Everybody can do some of that, absolutely.
And help others.
Does walking from the bedroom to the coffee pot in the morning count as fitness?
If you have somebody who normally serves it to you, I guess so. That would be a resolution to do it yourself.
I go outside and smoke, so I walk outside.
Yeah, that's kind of like walking. Yeah, sure.
Well, what about putting the coffee pot together, you know, so that you can have it on automatic brew in the morning?
Mine doesn't have an automatic brew on it.
Yeah, one with a timer on it, right?
Yeah,
no,
that's
I have one
are,
of those buns.
I've never used mine, but I have it. I have the option, but I'm just too damn lazy to set the freaking clock.
Or just have a coffee maker next to your bed.
That's
might as well. Yeah, that would be cool.
have it all set up or it's ready to brew in the morning, have it timed, and then just you start smelling the coffee, it'd wake you up. Best part of waking up is Folgers in your cup, right?
That's right. That's the good thing about having
the wake up and smell the coffee.
You know, it's interesting to me that, you know, we talked about resolutions and whether or not we keep them or whether or not we even believe that we have them. And, you know, in order to succeed in any goal, you need to understand that there are elements in changing behavior. And I think that is really at the key point of fulfilling a resolution, don't you think? I mean...
Well, like realistically.
Mm-hmm. Like
well,
28 days
yeah.
to break or make a habit, right?
I mean, you
well,
got these people that weigh 100 pounds that say that, you know, they're gonna lose 100 pounds by February. It's not realistic.
No.
Yeah, that's why there's important elements in changing the behavior. Number one, there has to be like a readiness to want to change. You have to have resources, you know, or maybe knowledge to make the lasting change successful. That's one of the reasons. Another, sometimes people make resolutions and there's barriers to their change. Okay.
Right.
So is there anything preventing you from actually changing? Maybe it is your situation. Maybe it's financial. So that's something. You know, maybe you don't want to make a goal that's, you know, unattainable. So maybe you have to start, you know, baby steps, as they say.
Right.
And number three, too, you can always expect, you know, that you're give yourself a break, that you're going to end up returning to the former behavior. You know, nobody wants to admit that, but unfortunately, you know, don't beat yourself up if you don't, you know, meet your resolution.
And there's another thing that that I've actually kind of tried myself a bit is stop therapy. If you're about to do something that you shouldn't do, whether it's say the wrong thing, maybe you don't want to swear anymore, or maybe you don't want to think negatively about yourself anymore, or maybe you're about to light up a cigarette, or whatever it is you're trying to quit, if you imagine a big red stop sign in front of you just basically screaming out, stop. You know, that's what stop therapy basically is. It's very simple, but I've read a lot about it, and it does actually work. I mean, if you have to even say it out loud, stop, you know, don't say hammer time. But, you know, if you're out in public, you might not want to do that because, you know, you'd look kind of crazy. But when you're in your own house, what the heck? And, you know, you're about ready to go in the refrigerator and go have some cheesecake, and I already had cheesecake today. You know, stop, what are you doing? You know, it does work.
I will definitely try that, and I don't care who I do it in front of.
Sherry will be at a concert.
Well,
like,
you know, and you know, Sherry, you were talking earlier that you really wanted to lose weight. That was your goal, right? You wanted to change your habits and to get more healthier. I don't know if that was to lose weight or. I don't want to make a misjudgment.
It's to lose
but,
weight and other health issues and stuff like that. I don't take care of myself and. Plus, I need to learn how to eat better. I am a fast food junkie because I run the I'm always running the streets and everything, and I live way out in the country, so it's easier to grab something and go home. And, you know, it's lunch and it's dinner most of the time, and it's ridiculous. And I've got to get control of it. And, of course, now I've got to lose about 35, 40 pounds, but I've got to learn how to eat right and be healthy and actually go all these little ailments I have, actually get them checked out and never know what it could be. You know, I don't have to deal, you know, with shoulder pain every single day. You know, I can go to a doctor. I just can't take off work and go do something about myself. It took me to go to the emergency room and couldn't take it anymore, and all I would have gallbladder attacks. But I was pressing on, and then finally I went to the emergency room. I had to leave work, went to the emergency room, and they had to remove my gallbladder. And I took one day off to have my gallbladder removed.
In any change that you're going to make sure that during the first part of changing it, because a lot of times what we do is we just kind of go, no, I'm going to do it, and, you know, we just go off out of the gate, and then we end up tripping up. So make sure that you prepare yourself.
It's
going to be plateaued.
Make sure that you prepare yourself for your changes. In other words, start experimenting with small changes in the beginning, you know, whether it is, okay, today I'm going to make my lunch, or today, you know, I'm going to, you know, eat this types of food. Or,
right.
You know.
Mm-hmm, like packing a lunch, because then you can control everything that's going in that, you know.
Yeah,
exactly.
It takes planning ahead. Yeah, you need to plan ahead, and because that's what one of the big things is to plan ahead, because the last minute, that's what you're going to do is go to fast food.
It's just so much easier. That's why it's called fast food, because it's fast.
Right.
I mean, you're in line maybe a couple minutes tops, and bam, your food's right there.
Not to mention
yeah.
that I'm sitting in an Arby's parking lot right now.
Like, I'm
no.
not even going to start talking about roast beef. You'll be in there in 2 seconds. We were on the phone. She'd be like, yeah, I'd like to get a roast beef with cheddar. Yeah, and, oh, I'm sorry. Oh, did I not mute it? Oh, crap.
I know, I was eating while I was on hold to get through. It's like 11 o'clock today, so.
But again,
yeah, that's it. You can't do that.
You got to cut it out.
Plan ahead.
It'll
save so much money, too.
Mm-hmm. Oh, absolutely. Even though it doesn't seem like it's a lot, you know, the dollar menu, whatever, if you sit down and figure out how much it runs you to make a lunch, it actually is a lot cheaper.
Well, yeah, you have to have that habit.
What it does to your body.
I think at the time that you save, too, you can sit and relax and eat your lunch instead of having to run out and get it and eat it really quickly so you can get back to work or get back to whatever you're doing.
Yeah,
also,
and another
too,
thing.
And I think I think I realized this last year was that when I started looking into, like, really simple recipes and stuff that you can make, which is, you know, good old vegetables and protein, you know, you can make a very easy, inexpensive meal, you know, by just having a few ingredients, and it's delicious. But we don't think of doing that. We think of going out and getting a burger real quick.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when it's
something in the microwave.
It's just as easy to grill up some chicken and vegetables.
Well,
really
here's an example, Robin. We were just talking about this. It's become a little bit more public about how unhealthy microwave popcorn is, and there's a lot of chemicals in it that cause lung problems.
Yeah,
kill you.
Yeah, we were talking about that.
So once I heard I started popping it in a pan with olive oil, and it's absolutely awesome. And it doesn't take long. It's under 5 minutes, and you've got a healthy snack. And then you can get the non-MSG flavors to sprinkle on it, or if you want your own Parmesan, whatever. And it's just, it doesn't take long. I mean,
yeah,
look,
that microwave popcorn,
minutes,
people, is very bad for you. Very, very bad.
For you. So it doesn't take much. You get a pot, you pour a little, you know, you pour, first of all, pour in how much you want to pop. And then you take the olive oil and make sure it's covering the kernels. And then you cover it and you just watch it. Don't walk away because it's less than 5 minutes. And it tastes just like butter to me. If you get the right olive oil, like the extra light is usually really good for that.
What
and,
about
you?
I've been
doing
a small amount of kernels, makes a lot of popcorn.
High school, I mean, this is like over 20 years, my trademark, making that popcorn on the stove with the olive oil.
Mm-hmm.
It's
and olive oil is so
good
for you. It's so good. It's one of those healthy saturated fats.
You know something I have not had since I was a kid in food that I have not put in food? My mom stopped putting it in food, and I haven't added it to any food other than corn on the cob since I was a kid. I don't cook with it. I don't do anything with it.
Why
that's
is that?
Salt.
Oh.
I love salt.
Actually, if you get the proper salt, which is sea salt, Himalayan pink is the best. Actually, it's good for you.
I get the sea salt, but when I was a kid, I got a headache one day, and this headache lasted for days. I'd wake up with it, go to bed with it.
Ionized salt.
Had MRIs and all that stuff, and then finally the doctor said to my mom, just out of, you know, curiosity, to stop cooking with salt. And when
mm-hmm.
she stopped putting salt in things, the headaches went away. And since she
well,
did
ionized
when I was a kid,
is actually bad for you, Steve. I'm sure your mom was using ionized, right? Most people do.
Yeah, regular salt. Now, I had sea salt. Like I said, I can't eat corn on the cob without salt, but I don't put salt on french fries. I don't put salt on anything.
Actually, fries are good with pepper.
Yes.
Now that I put on everything. I eat pepper on everything. I'm a pepper fanatic.
Yeah,
I'm quite a seasoner. I like my food seasoned, so I use kosher salt. But yeah, so
I do eat it too.
I don't think I've ever heard anything bad. With salt. I mean, with pepper.
Yeah. Wow, it's turned into a health conversation. We're definitely going to have some nutrition conversations eventually here too.
There's a seasoning called no salt. We use this at work, and it's sodium free.
It's a salt that's sodium free?
Yeah, it's really cool.
You mean like non-salt, where it's like fake salt? Sometimes you got to watch those things. The things that pretend to be something and they're not, they're usually very chemically made.
Mm-hmm.
You're better off, like right. Like with sugar. The corn syrup, high fructose corn syrup is horrible and it's making us all fat. It's awful for you.
You
need
the
regular
corn
washed sugar.
Federation tells us that it's not bad for us.
They're lying to us, so they don't care. But that's another topic altogether.
Everything needs moderation.
Exactly.
Butter's actually not bad for you. We've been lied to all these years. Margarine's worse.
Right. It's chemical.
Your body can't break it down because it's not natural.
I love mustard.
Mustard's actually good for you. Mustard seed is awesome for you.
I like mustard.
These are all
I
the
like
things
honey
that
mustard.
We're going to try out in the new year, right?
This is the most mustard. Honest radio show that we've had yet, I think,
know.
Shadow.
That's great.
People are going to go, what are they doing on that show? What are they doing?
I love Cadbury eggs. I love the Cadbury eggs. Am I okay with that?
They're horrible for you. I'm not going to lie to you.
Definitely okay with that.
They look gross.
But the people who love them
bad.
Love them so much.
Danielle,
so bad,
Danielle.
Good. Yeah, yes,
as
yes.
Long as you eat one and you go, muck, 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 muck.
And I do.
Okay, that hurts.
Are you laying on a button?
Yeah, we don't like that. Just mute us all, Lisa.
Okay, I just muted. I don't want to say the number out loud, but I just figured out who it was that it was happening with. But I'm not sure by the number who it is for sure.
Okay.
Everybody say hello and say who they are, and we'll find out who I just muted.
Okay. Hello, it's Daniel.
No, we didn't.
Hello. Hello, Renee.
I'm trying to think whose number this is. Crap.
Was it mine?
No, it's not. It's neither you nor Robin because the area codes match up. It's not Danielle. I think it's Cherie. This happened one of the other times she called. I think it happened to her. Where she had that happen. Okay, let's call it to Cherie, and if she doesn't answer, we know that I'm right. Oh, she's typing. I bet it was her phone.
Oh, no.
You may have to call back if it's going to keep screaming at us. That
was
awesome.
Was that Arby's?
That was just to wake us up.
Yeah. She fell asleep on the phone again.
She says,
okay.
I'm no longer on. That's
wasn't
weird.
She the one that was in
I muted her. I muted you, Cherie. I guess you can hear me, so yeah. I'm going to go ahead and disconnect you and then call back because we need you to call back. We want you on. So I'm going to go ahead and click the X and call right back. And if you're eating Arby's, I'm going to come over there and yell at you. Okay. She put that sound on so we didn't hear her chewing.
Oh,
that's what it was. She's like,
grease on the phone.
These are good sandwiches. Yeah, I want her to just call back because I don't know.
Oh,
I don't believe her phone that does that. Anywho, well, as a little roundup here, just to let people know, we've got about 10 minutes to go. About the last minute, I'm going to be doing the outro as I always do. And I know shortly before that, Robin has something really cool to share with us. So I'm just letting everybody know our time here. We probably got maybe about another 7 or 8 minutes before we need to wind things up, at least maybe 6.
Well, I'll share what I did. Does anybody know what Auld Lang Syne is about? Anybody? Anybody know what it's about?
I do, but I'm not going to say.
Well, not you.
Okay, I'll play along. No, I have no idea, Robin. Please share.
No, it's already gone off. Does anybody know what it's about?
Nope.
Anybody? Has anybody sang it?
Of course. Who hasn't heard
that song?
Everybody butchers that one. While you're kissing somebody. Auld Lang Syne. Right?
Yeah. Does anybody know what it means? Does anybody know what that song means?
No.
I always wondered what. Well,
okay, I'm just
going
to get cheery on, and then I want you to tell us what that means, okay?
Okay, yeah.
I mean, Cherie. Sorry. Cherie, is that you?
It's me.
Hey, I knew it was you. Were you eating a burger? Sorry, roast beef? Did you sneak and eat roast beef?
I've been thinking for that.
Okay, Robin's going to tell us. Robin was about to tell us what Auld Lang Syne means. So,
does anybody know? Renee?
You know? You know, Cherie?
No.
All right, Rob, tell us. We want to know.
Anybody?
Nope.
Okay. Well, actually, it was a Scottish poem that was written in 1788, and it's normally set to the tune of a traditional folk song, which we've all sang it. And what it actually is, it's a rhetorical question. It says, should we really think about whether it's right or wrong that old times should be forgotten, which I didn't know. You know, when I looked this up today, I thought, what does that song mean? I never knew what the song meant. I mean, we kind of, you know, we all sing it wrong. We all kind of muddle through
it. One of the most butchered songs, I know it.
Yeah, and you know, it's one of the most used songs. There's over 25 to 30 films that have used this song. There's over, I don't know how many artists that have copied the song, from Beyonce to, I mean, Jimi Hendrix.
Right.
Josh Ritter, Bobby Darin, mm-hmm. Prince,
Cindy
Billy
Lauper,
Joel. I mean, they've all done covers and renditions of the song.
Mm-hmm.
And I always thought to myself, what does this song mean? Normally we think, oh, well, it's to symbolize, you know, endings and new beginnings, you know. And, you know, that is true. But actually, it's a rhetorical question that was posed. And I thought that was kind of interesting.
Huh. That makes me feel better because I always wondered why it would say some of the stuff it says. That would seem right to forget about it.
Well, one of the verses, now this was redone kind of by a guy by the name of James Watson in 1711, but this is the words, and this is what really hit me today, too. And I'm going to muddle through this, but it's one of the verses, and it says, since thoughts of thee doth banish grief, when from thee I am gone, will not thy presence yield relief to this sad heart of mine? Why doth thy presence me defeat with excellence divine, especially when I reflect on Auld Lang Syne? And what that he's basically saying is, we need to remember. We need to, maybe we shouldn't forget the people that have gone. Maybe all those we need to
keep them alive.
As a call to remember longstanding friendships. And so, when you toast and you're singing Auld Lang Syne this year, know that it's a call to remember those longstanding friendships and those people in your life that have either passed on or that are still with us. And it's something
maybe
good, you know.
People who you don't talk to anymore that maybe, you know, some negative things happen, maybe wish them well and just, you know, don't forget
everything.
He has lesson, you know. It's all about lessons, and it's important to remember everybody who's gone.
Yeah. So it's a rhetorical question. Should we remember those people? Absolutely, I think we should.
And with that, this is the sound effect I must share.
That's exactly what I was thinking.
And of course, this sound too. Oh,
I have so much fun looking up sounds. Can you tell, Alyssa? She's like, I can tell.
So if anybody says, what is that song about? You know, why do we want to forget those people? Now you can tell them, yeah.
It's about the times that have passed and letting in the future and keeping the past there, too. Learning from it.
Yeah.
Well, it's the final countdown here. We're looking at about 4 minutes here, and I need at least a bit. Our next show, and I may or may not start it on Wednesday. I wanted to do open session Wednesdays, or basically called free for all Wednesdays, where we just kind of let the conversation randomly go where it may, and just start talking about whatever.
Well, that could be interesting.
If everybody's willing to call me back, and we definitely have a good group of people doing it, because I'm a little nervous. I don't want to have an empty line, just have Robin and I talking about whatever. If everybody's going to be willing to call in, same bat channel, same time, but I'm thinking only for like an hour, just for the first one to give it a try and see how it goes. And I'd like to do that on Wednesday, so if you guys think it's a cool idea, I thought about doing that on Wednesday.
Hey, Lise, how many minutes do we got?
We got two.
I said the wrong verse. Can I say this one verse real quick?
Okay, sure. Go ahead.
O Lang Syne, here we go. My heart is ravished with delight when thee I think upon. All the grief and sorrow takes flight and is speedily is gone. The bright resemblance of thy face so feels this heart of mine that force not fate can me displease for O Lang Syne. And I thought that was neat, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Did you guys get it? Guess not.
Mm-hmm.
What a way to end the show.
But thank you for sharing that, Robin, and thank you, everyone, for calling in. This has been the best show yet. I've had such a good time. I feel like I'm just sitting around and having a phone party with all you guys, and it's just been so much fun, and I hope that you will continue to call back because I really enjoy everybody, and all your support means so much to me and, of course, Robin, and we wouldn't have such a great show if it wasn't for you guys calling in, and, of course, Robin, my great co-host. So I just want to wish all of you a little bit early a very, very happy new year, and I wish you all well, and I hope that whatever dreams and hopes that you have, that at least one of them comes true. And I just love you guys, and I just want to tell you that before I do the outro in about another minute. So if everyone wants to say goodbye, I just want to thank you again, and we will look forward to a show on Wednesday. So love you
guys.
Happy
New Year, everybody.
Happy
Enjoy
New
your
Year. Love you, Dad.
All right, guys, love you. We will talk to you next show Wednesday from 10 to 11 Eastern Standard Time.
Yep.
See you in 2012. Bye-bye, everybody.
That's right. Bye, everyone.
Bye, everybody.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.